All right, ladies and gentlemen, welcome to the Revelations Per Minute broadcast. Our first guest is Lindsey Williams, and I just spoke with him. He's calling in even as we speak. And let me do this. We are going to say a quick word of prayer. LindseyWilliams.net is his website, and he will, of course, brief you on his history, but I know he was a chaplain at one time in the oil fields in the 70s when things were a lot different than they are now. But he'll brief us on all that. But in the meantime, let's say, Lord, we want to honor you and worship you and praise you and welcome you into this show. Let everything said tonight be to your glory and for the benefit of the kingdom of God and our brothers and sisters to be edified in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. So Pastor Williams was given, amen, the northern seven out of the 28 construction camps, including the oil field at Prudhoe Bay, to hold worship service at the seven camps once a day. And this was, as I mentioned, in the 70s. And after 6 months of PR employee, at Alaska Pipeline Company told Pastor Lindsey Williams that he was an invaluable asset to the company. So we find him to be an invaluable asset still as he's maintained these connections. Lindsey, welcome to the show. And I won't ramble too much because I know you've got some things that you want to share with us.
Well, Brian, thank you so much for allowing me to be with you today. And yes, things are happening so rapidly out there. Things are taking place that people need to know about. I would beg every person in your listening audience right now to please call five other people immediately and tell them to listen to this 1 hour's program. It will probably be the most informative time that they will spend listening or viewing anything today. So please call a friend and neighbor, and please take notes on what you're about to hear. This has not hit the national news yet. I was given it 2 days ago. I've only given this on one program since then, and it is so startling that you're going to see it happen down the road 3 to 4 months from now. You'll see it come out in the open. In the meantime, every person out there, Brown, needs to know what's happening right now.
Well, I guess we do, but sometimes we don't like to hear this type of thing. But go ahead, Lindsey, and tell us what you done found out again.
Well, you'll want to hear this. This is not something that's going to keep you awake at night.
Oh, good.
This will be one of the greatest assets that you can possibly imagine to your family's well-being.
Okay.
And so please, don't be afraid. You don't have to turn the radio off. This you need to hear for the sake of your dinner table and your household. And if you know what I'm about to tell you, you can save yourself great heartache while others are suffering drastically. So everything you're about to hear is to your benefit. And if you will take action and take this to heart, you'll be amazed how much good it will do you. Now, let me begin where all this started with me.
All right.
Back about 4 years ago, there was a gentleman by the name of Mr. Ken Fromm. He was a senior executive with Atlantic Richfield, and he knew everything that goes on behind closed doors. He was one of them. He had the authority by the 9 major oil companies of America of building the entire east side of the Prudhoe Bay oil field. That's what a gentleman he was. After he left the Trans-Alaska Oil Pipeline, he went on to be, I believe, the CEO of Atlantic Richfield, one of the largest oil companies in America. This man died about a year and a half ago. He was 87 years of age. And he told me a lot of things before he passed away. He told me some things I've never even told yet. People would think they were too outlandish. But the elite do have things planned for you, for America. And if you know what's going on, you can spare yourself great heartache. Now, about that same time that we were talking about what was going to happen in America as far as the financial situation in this country was concerned, I was put in touch with a Wall Street insider, a gentleman who spent many years on Wall Street. He started out his career in his 20s as a Wall Street executive. And 30 years ago, approximately, 30, 35 years ago, this gentleman was told to start selling something. He had never even heard the word before. The word was derivatives. Now, if you don't know what a derivative is, you must do a crash course on them immediately. If you can watch the derivative market, you will be able to know everything that's going to happen 3 to 6 months in advance of it happening. And when I was put in touch with this Wall Street insider, he said to me, he said, "Chaplain, 35 years ago when I was on Wall Street as a young man, he said, I was told to sell these, and he said, shortly thereafter, my superior came to me and explained to me what this was all about. And in a nutshell, this is it. Derivatives are probably some of the most complicated financial instruments in the world. They are a glorified banker's multi-billion dollar syndicate of gambling. Now, you heard me correctly.
My goodness.
There is approximately $1 quadrillion invested in the derivative market today. We can't even comprehend that. It is beyond our thinking. And it is unregulated. There is no law in the United States of America that regulates any bank or the Federal Reserve. And foreign banks, in fact, every bank in the world is very heavily invested in the derivative market. Now, that started about 35 years ago. And this gentleman was told that the derivative market was to be developed to the point where it is today. He knew in advance that was going to happen over a period of years. Mm-hmm. They also told him that the derivative market would be, now please catch this expression, that the derivative market would be the method whereby the elite would bring all of the currencies of the world. Now you heard that word, all. America, the euro, China, Japan, India, I care not who they are, that the derivative market was being developed for the purpose of being able to bring all the currencies of the world to a position of destruction whenever they got ready to do it. In other words, they could collapse the entire worldwide financial system with the derivative market whenever they developed it to the point that they wanted it to go. Now, when I was given that, I was also given some other things. American taxpayers, through the Federal Reserve, are exposed right now, today. You don't even realize this because the Federal Reserve won't tell you things like this. Some of the top financial people of the world know it. The American taxpayers are exposed right now to $291 trillion in the derivative market. Now, you think that your $16 trillion national debt is something. That's nothing. You're exposed to $291 trillion through the Federal Reserve that you're obligated for as a taxpayer in the derivative market. Now, when I heard these things, the first thing I wanted to know was, how can I tell when the derivative market is going to crash? Did you catch this?
Uh-huh.
I wanted to know for the sake of my family, my wife,
yeah,
my son. I wanted to know in advance. These people know. They know exactly what they're doing. And I said, I would like to know, if you're willing to tell me, will you please tell me how I can know the stage of the derivative market and some indicators as to when you will collapse the derivative market. Now, before I go any further, I need to tell you what happened to me just a few weeks ago. And then I will give you the signs. I'm going to give you some signs today, some of the most important signs that you will ever receive concerning the financial world are going to be given to you in a few moments. And you will take it to heart. Now, let me tell you what happened to me a few weeks ago. It was just after the election. Mm-hmm. And business friends of mine, in every kind of business imaginable, you know, after 37 years of what I've been doing, I know so many people in the business world, and on and on you go. And some friends of mine in the business world were at their wit's end. They said, Chaplain, we don't know what we're going to do. We don't know whether to expand our business or to close our business. With the election of this new president, they said, we don't know what to do with our business. We don't know whether to invest or get out. What do we do? Can your elite friend tell you anything that will help us? Well, I knew he could. And so I went to him. Now, you remember Mr. Fromm died about a year and a half ago. There's another gentleman that was Mr. Fromm's associate that still gives me information on a regular basis, and he's retired. but he knows what's going on. And I did. I contacted him. And I said, can you please tell me what's happening? Over about the next 3 to 4 days, I received some of the most unusual emails of information that you could ever imagine. And when I put together the information that I had received from this man, I realized that I had everything that that the New World Order plans to do over the next 4 years.
Wow.
You said, this administration, everything.
Everything.
That they, every major thing that they're going to do over the next 4 years, I had it in the palm of my hand. And basically, it is 10 agendas that the American people will face. Now, I don't have time to cover those today, but I want to tell you what I did. 10 agendas that the American people will face over the next 4 years' time, and you will. You'll face every one of these. And if you know in advance what they are, it can save you great, great heartache. Well, I was so startled over what I had gotten until I said, I must tell the American people. And I went before the cameras in studio, and it took me 3 hours and 29 minutes just to explain what I had heard. 3 hours and 29 minutes just to explain it. And when I got through, I said, I can't release this. I was so startled with what, with the information and with what I had actually produced until when I viewed it. Now, keep in mind something. I was a pastor of a church for 12 years, a fairly decent-sized church in Florida. I was a missionary for many years in Alaska. And you don't do that without having a pastor's heart and a heart for people. And my heart so went out to the people, I said, if I give this out like it is right now, I said, I'm doing people an injustice. I contacted two individuals that I know. Two of them that are probably, in my mind, some of the most prominent people in the financial world today. And one of them is Tom Fowler. And I said, would you be willing to help me? I said, and I gave them all these details. I sent them my outline. They viewed the DVD and came back to me, and they said, Lindsay, you need our help, and we need your help. And we went, the three of us, went back in studio, and it took us 2 hours and 50 minutes. And all we did was gave solutions to the 10 agendas of the next 4 years. No doom and gloom whatsoever. We gave nothing but solutions. We worked on this for a week or two before we did it. I said, I want a solution for the millionaire. I want a solution for the middle-class American. I want a solution for the street person. And I said, we have got to give solutions to these 10 agendas that every American is going to face over the next 4 years. And it took us 2 hours and 50 minutes to produce solutions for everybody. Nothing but solutions for that entire time. We're going to put it all together. We had a 6.5-hour DVD series that just came out about 2 weeks ago. Mm-hmm. And it's everything that you're going to face for the next 4 years. Now, one of them deals with the derivative subject, which I have just tried to explain to you, and now I'd like to tell you what's happened. And then I'll give you what happened over the next 3 days, over the last 3 days. When I was explained derivatives, the gentleman told me, he said, Chaplain, there are three ways that you can understand the derivative market and know how, before it's going to collapse. He said, we know when it's going to collapse. And he said, we know the signs. But he said, I'll give you the signs. I want you to write them down right now.
All right.
I won't be able to give them in lengthy detail, but I want you to write them down. He said, number one, whenever you see currency wars beginning to escalate, he said, watch out. That is one of the signs that the derivative market is beginning its explosion. Mm. And he said, we'll be able to explode it when we want to. But he said, one of the signs. Now, their cohorts know how to watch these signs. They know from the insiders what to watch. And they already protected themselves. He said, number one is currency wars. I'm going to explain that to you in just a moment, what happened. Secondly, they said currency wars will bring on trade wars. Now, I didn't know a thing about trade wars. But when they got through explaining to me what trade wars are, I was dumbfounded. I want to give you an example of one because you heard it, but whether you understood what you were hearing or not, I'm not quite sure.
All right.
Back in February of 2012, China and Japan signed the largest trade agreement that's ever been signed between two nations on the face of this earth. Now, keep in mind, China's the number two economy in the world, Japan's number the three economy in the world, America's number one, but China and Japan signed a trade war, a trade agreement, and they agreed that they would buy and sell products amongst themselves and that they would use the Chinese currency to do it and would no longer use the reserve currency of the world, which is the American dollar. And China and Japan, the second and third largest economy in the world, have now, for approximately the last year's time, been buying and selling products amongst themselves, and they have not used the American dollar. This is a trade war against the United States of America. I could go on and list many of these, but I don't have time. Now,
yes.
Number one, he said there'll be currency wars. He said, number two, there will be trade wars that will come out of the currency wars.
Uh-huh.
Now, I'm going to give you the final key. Please, you can see this. You will hear it on the national news when it happens. It hasn't happened yet. Whenever it happens, you will look back at the Radio Preacher Man show today, Brian Wilson, and you'll say he had a prophet on his program. And whatever you do, I'm going to tell you right now, I'm not a prophet. Don't you dare say that when you see this happen a few months from now. I'm telling you what I've been given in advance because I appreciate you, I care about you, I have a heart for people, and I'm trying my best to help you.
Mm-hmm.
Number one, you'll see currency wars. Number two, you'll see trade wars. And number three, whenever you hear that the Federal Reserve is about to raise interest rates, it's all over. Did you catch that?
Yes,
I did. The day that you hear, and it'll be announced, the Federal Reserve will be announced. They're kind of hinting at it recently. The day that they announced that they're going to begin raising interest rates, the Federal Reserve, on its T-bills and its bonds and its securities, the moment that they announce that, if you haven't gotten out of paper by that time, you've lost it. Now, I mean every kind of paper. 401K, IRA, retirement fund, bank account, checking account, money between the mattress. If it is written on a piece of paper, it is worth the paper it's written on. And whenever they announce interest rate rise, that is the signal to all of this inner core of the New World Order that the derivative market is about to collapse.
Dear
and
God.
Whenever the derivative market collapses, you will see your bank account dwindle. You'll see the American dollar go to practically nothing. You'll see the currencies of the wars of the world affected. And you must take precaution before that happens. Now, I gave you those keys very, very briefly. It took me hours to explain them on a DVD. In fact, I think it was back, I called it The Secrets of the Elite. I produced it about a year and a half ago. And I gave a in-depth study of this entire situation on that DVD series. Now, the latest series that we just produced, that just came out about 2 weeks ago, is entitled The Next 4 Years. And the sequel to it, How to Survive the Next 4 Years. And it's available right now. But here's what I want to give you. 3 days ago, it started. Did you catch it?
No, I didn't want to hear that.
you did not, you will not hear this on the national evening news. No, I didn't say interest rate rise. I did not say that. It's not gotten that far yet. You've still got time.
Okay.
But you've got to know the indicators. Now, three days ago, a major escalation in currency wars, which is the first signal. Remember, there was currency wars, and there was trade wars, and then there were interest rate rise, which if you wait until you hear that, you've waited too late. And 3 days ago, Japan started an escalation of the currency wars that literally swept the world. Now, let me try to explain this. Here again, you will see this already in a few of the very knowledgeable financial newsletters. The rest of them haven't even picked up on it yet. I was given this by an inside source. And you're going to begin to see it now. The national news won't tell you this. They don't want you to know it. It started in Japan. And the Japanese said to the United States Federal Reserve, are you catching this now?
Yeah.
They said, we've had enough of your quantitative easing. Now, do you realize?
But I heard they were doing the same thing in Japan.
Yeah. Well, they can't do it because they don't have a Federal Reserve. So they can't do what the United States of America did because Japan doesn't have a Federal Reserve. And this is the thing that is causing these nations to literally go ballistic, is because in the last year of the administration of George Bush, the Federal Reserve convinced Congress that the whole world's financial system was going to collapse. If the Federal Reserve didn't issue trillions of dollars in Federal Reserve issues and make it available to the banks of the world. And yeah, they had it timed, ready to go. I mean, it would have happened. It wasn't just a threat. It literally would have happened. And you heard this expression, QE1.
Yeah.
Well, they did. They gave trillions of dollars away to the banks of America, the lending institutions, and to the lending institutions of the world. Then the bankers decided they needed more money. And so they came around to QE2. And that was about halfway through the Obama administration, his first year, his first term. And they said, we've got to have QE2. If you don't, everything's still getting so bad, the world's not getting any better. We got to have some more trillions of dollars out of the American coffer. And if you don't, the whole world's going to collapse. Mm. It enraged China and Japan and Taiwan and Thailand and South Korea and Brazil. Literally enraged them. In fact, the president of Brazil came to the... I think her name is Mr. Rochoff. She came to the United States of America about a year ago, and she stood in front of our president and blessed him out. She said, you can't do this anymore. She said, you are destroying our Brazilian currency. She said, we don't have a Federal Reserve. We can't pull money out of thin air like you're doing and make the world believe that it has some value. And she said, you are holding up the American Federal Reserve note while you are destroying our currency and our financial status in Brazil and many other countries. And she said, Mr. President, if you initiate another quantitative easing, you're going to have the whole world come down on your back. It scared America. And they kind of backed off a little bit. And on September the 13th of 2012, when the Federal Reserve announced that they were going to pull $40 billion out of thin air every month and buy mortgage-backed securities, they did not call it QE3. Now, some of the financial newsletters had the audacity to call it something that Mr. Bernanke didn't call it. The reason he didn't call it QE3 is because he thought that maybe the rest of the world wouldn't catch it. And so he just said, this is what we're going to do. Well, the world did catch it.
Yeah,
and
they know that's stupid.
That even, they realized that, he realized, they're beginning to realize now, and they are realizing, that this literally was a QE3. It's just that Mr. Bernanke didn't call it that. So they finally had all they could take. And 3 days ago, Japan was the first one. They said, okay, America, if you're going to play Russian roulette, we're going to play it your way. They said, we are going to change the value of our currency.
Yeah.
Now, to the average person, that wouldn't mean a thing in the world. And right on the heels of Japan, China got fed up.
Yeah.
And they said, America, we've had it with you. Your currency, your economy is in shambles. Your currency is in a mess. Japan has decided to take action, and we have also decided to take action. Now, this did not hit the national news. And I'm giving you the countries, and I'm even going to read you the statement of the Chinese Foreign Exchange Regulator. Did you catch that? Now, I have your pencils ready.
Now, Lindsay, I did
his statement in just a moment.
I did hear something about they were changing the values of their currencies, and it was in one ear and out the other. I didn't even know what the heck that meant. I mean, how do you just change the value of your currency? So I'm glad I have you on tonight, because that kind of went over my head. I heard it, but it didn't stay with me. It didn't register. It didn't mean anything to me, as you just said. I was one of those most of the people. But now that you're here...
Let me try to explain what that meant.
Okay.
Right now, the Chinese currency is 0.05 to 1 with the American dollar. That means that the Chinese currency is worth much less than the American dollar. What China did was they said, okay, if you're going to keep on playing this game of quantitative easing, we are going to change the value of our currency to, I'm just going to take a figure out of the hat, 0.10. Now, what happens, you go to Walmart, you go to Target, and you find everything on the shelves, Nelly, made in Japan, made in China. Now, whenever you buy that product from Walmart, Walmart has to turn around and replace that product. And if that product is made in China, they got it before at 50 cents. This time Walmart's going to have to pay 75 cents for that product. Are you catching this?
Mm-hmm.
Now, it hasn't shown up on the shelves yet. It'll take a few months for it to happen. And when it does, oh my goodness, what you are going to face, because those products from Japan, from China, are now going to, when they're replaced by Walmart and Target, are going to be replaced according to the new value that those currencies have set on their, the new value that they've set on their currency compared to the American dollar. So Walmart will now have to pay 75 cents for that 50 cent item. If you buy it from Japan, you may pay 60 cents on that 50 cent item. So what's going to happen when Walmart brings it into the store and they have to make a profit?
Well, they raise the price. Yeah, they're going to raise the price of the item, sure.
But let's say that that price goes up from 50 to 75 cents. Do you realize that that is a devaluation of the dollar?
Mm-hmm.
No. You say, well, what do you mean a devaluation of the dollar? The dollar was worth 50 cents. Now it takes 75 cents of those same dollars to buy the same thing that you could buy for 50 cents last month.
Yeah.
So what happened to the dollar? Well, you see, the dollar, I can still take it to the grocery store and the hardware store and buy things with it. Yeah, you can. But what price are you going to pay? And you say, well, my dollar is still worth the same thing. No, it's not. Your dollar now has devalued. It has lost its purchasing power. You know, folks, if you will buy anything at all, you better go buy it right now. Now, don't go in and get take out a loan to do it. You can't do it that way.
No.
But if you've got money to buy things with, you better go and buy it right now, because you are going... Okay, I want to give you the nations in order. Number one, Japan. Japan started this 3 days ago.
Mm-hmm.
They said, we've had enough. And we're not going to put up with your American gambling syndicate any longer. And Japan also knows that America could collapse the entire financial world with its derivative market. They know that. So then China stepped into the arena the identical same day. Now, I'm going to give you his name. He is the DBOC, I don't know what that stands for, in China, Deputy Governor. DBOC, Chinese Deputy Governor, and his name is Yi Gang, Yi Gang, Come on now. I'm giving you facts and figures, folks. You don't have to take Lindsay Williams' word for this. I'm trying to warn you of something. And Mr. Wygang, I'm going to give you his exact words. He said, I warn you on currency wars. Then he said, listen to this one. Quantitative easing for developed economies is generating some uncertainty in financial markets in turn of capital flow. Now, I know these sound like big words, but I got to give you his exact words because these are dynamite. Do you realize that nearly everything in Walmart and Target and your hardware store is made in China?
And you know, I was aware of that, yes.
Now, this man said, this DBOC Deputy General, Wai Chang, said, I'm warning you, America. And what did he warn on? Oh, peace, people. You heard what my friend told me when he explained derivatives to me, and I took over nearly 3 hours to explain it on DVD, and he said the first sign of a major event taking place in the derivative market is when currency wars begin. Currency wars will bring on trade wars, and trade wars will force the Federal Reserve, whether they like to or not, to raise interest rates. And he said, Chaplain, whenever you hear the interest rates are being raised, he said, it is all over. Now, the currency wars began. They began 3 days ago. They're escalating rapidly. Now, I want to give you some more statements here.
God, be with us.
This statement is something else. Now, Mr. Yi, Y-I-G-A-N-G, he is head of China's foreign exchange, also foreign exchange regulator. And I want to read you another one of his statements. He said, competitive devaluation is one aspect of it. If everything is doing super, QE, which currency, will depreciate. In other words, he asked, I mean, folks, these people are brilliant. They know exactly what's going on out there. He said, if you continue, I'm going to put it in my words now. He said, if you continue QE, he said, I want to ask you a question. Which one of our currencies are going to devalue?
Well, it makes sense that ours would because there's more of them in circulation, Lindsay.
Well, by creating QE1-2, we devalued the Chinese currency. Now the Chinese are turning around and saying, you've added America.
Napuda. That's Korean for bad.
Yeah, you've had it.
Close to Chinese.
Now we're going to turn the tables on you. And now we are going to change the value of our currency. And even though we can't bring about a QE1 or a QE2, we're going to destroy your dollar.
Well, you know what I think? I think the end result is going to be there's going to be so much debt and such that they'll probably, when the Antichrist gets on the scene, he'll just say, okay, we're starting over, wipe everything clean. Nobody owes nobody, but you're all taking this chip and you're only getting this much to live on. Of course, you know, the elite will always have their ways of getting an extra big chip, so to speak. But that's just me talking, Lindsay. But go ahead and tell us what is the next thing we got to look for, I guess.
I want to give you the other nations that fell right in line with all of this because it happened so rapidly until it was almost like a set of dominoes going over. That morning, there was first of all Japan.
Mm-hmm.
And then immediately China, I guess they probably had already communicated amongst each other. Immediately China came along and said what you just heard me, Mr. Yang said. Mm-hmm. Immediately after that, Taiwan stepped in, same day, 3 days ago.
Yeah.
Taiwan's central bank said that they are going to step into FX market. Now, I don't know what that means. If you were Chinese,
I think that's the trading currency, isn't it? Is that where you trade currency?
Yeah, I think it probably is. Yeah. So Taiwan said, we are going to step into the FX market. Then, immediately, Thailand stepped in. And their currency, they said, we've had enough. So their currency is called the PARSARN. I don't even know how to pronounce it. And they stepped in immediately and said, we're going to adjust our currency. Then, within hours, people, within hours, South Korea.
Now that's our ally.
Yes.
I served over there for 2 years, so what did they do then, Lindsay?
Okay, the South Koreans said this. They said, we're the BOK. Now, whatever that may be, that's one of the currency exchanges, I guess, of South Korea. They said, the BOK, global currency, war has begun. Did you catch this? I'm reading right off
they
of the...
They actually said those words?
Yes, they actually said the BOK said that the global currency war is spreading. Global currency war. And that was exactly what my friend had said to me back over 2 years ago. He said, Chaplain, when this starts, he said, it will spread like wildfire all over everything. He said, begin to watch very carefully. Now, you can understand, Brian, why tonight I was a little concerned about being on your program, because I knew that your audience had to hear this, and they needed to get it out, and you and I were a little conflicting on time frames here, so I was glad that I finally got in touch with you, because I just walked into my office when you called. I wasn't expecting to do the program until an hour later.
We weren't sure about that mountain time, you know, pardon us for that. We sometimes struggle with time zones. You know, but
so
it all worked out. So,
what our greatest concern is right now is for everyone out there in your listening audience to know how to watch currency wars and trade wars and to understand the derivative market. And you still have those pencils and paper there handy. Would you please jot this down? I need you to write down our toll-free number, and also the place on the web with the new presentation. It's 6.5 hours long, DVD, professionally done. I couldn't stop with 3 hours and 29 minutes. I was so startled over what we had produced until we went back in studio with these financial professionals and had them to help me tell you what to do about it. 2 hours and 50 minutes of nothing but solutions. Our toll-free number, if you'd like to help your neighbors and save your family a lot of heartache and know the next 4 years and how to survive the next 4 years, please call our toll-free number. It's 1-888-799-6111. Or, after the program today, if you wish, you can go on the web to prophecyclub.com. That's PROPHECYCLUB.com. Or, once again, toll free, 888-799-6111. And you can get the next 4 years and how to survive the next 4 years. It's a companion DVD set that will tell you all of the 10 agendas of the New World Order, the elite, Mr. Obama, and what they plan to do over the next 4 years, and you will face all of these agendas over the next 4 years. It will happen. There are things that you can avoid. You can spare yourself much heartache if you know what to do. And this is the reason I'm trying my best to help you know them, is so that you won't stay awake at night. You don't need to look behind bushes. You don't need to look for black helicopters. You can do what many people did. You know, 1929 through 1933 was the Great Depression. And there were many people who made great fortunes at that time. Not everybody stood in a soup line. But the people who knew what was going to happen and had made preparations for it and had invested correctly, they were able to survive it and make great fortunes at that time. Now, I want to tell you what Mr. Tom Fowler did. I have in my hand right here in front of me the most beautiful booklet that you can imagine of. Tom Fowler called me the other day and he said, "Lindsay, I am so concerned about Americans." He said, "After I helped you make that DVD series," he said, "I have produced a 24-page booklet." Now, it is a beautiful full-color cover and beautifully done. And Tom Fowler felt so concerned after he knew the 10 agendas of the elite until he said, "Lindsay, I'm going to give this away to everyone who buys your DVDs." That's right. If you order this new DVD set, the next 4 years, or How to Survive the Next 4 Years, the people out there that are producing have Tom Fowler's beautiful 24-page, and I want to give you just a few of the titles in here that he's trying his best to help you with. He says, "Buy Right and Hedge." He says, use of the investment market. There's another one in called The Stock Market. There's another section here in called 401k and IRA. There's another section entitled Precious Metals. There's another section entitled The Depreciation of the U.S. Dollar. I mean, this man has produced a masterpiece. Another one called Small Business. Another one called Overseas Asset Placement. And yeah, another one about, it just goes on and on and on. I mean, this man was a Wall Street insider for years, and he knows the Lord. He left Wall Street, couldn't take the corruption up there any longer. And he's going to give you this as a gift, that brochure only. Now, you'll have to purchase the DVDs, but the brochure will come to you as a gift with the DVD set that Tom Fowler wants you to have. And you can know in advance what's taking place and save yourself a lot of heartache, Brian.
Wow. Well, that's always wise to have that foresight, Lindsay, and to know in advance when possible. So much of life is unpredictable anyway. So, I tell you, Lindsay, I feel like they did wrong on the QE1. I mean, it's bad enough that they came up with that scenario, and I know that there's a lot of people with an agenda that's way beyond us normal folks. But, you know, instead of giving that money to the banks, they could have given, like, every household 50 grand and made a stipulation that if you have a mortgage, it goes on your mortgage. And that would have fixed the banks. That would have fixed the people being upside down so much on their house. It would have just rectified so many things. And those people that were renting, they could have just went out and bought a car or used that money to use as a down payment on a home. You see, there, it would have so fixed so many areas of our economy to do it from the bottom up, Lindsay, instead of starting with the banks and that money kind of disappeared. You know how it went. Some of it's actually unaccountable for, if I'm not mistaken.
You are correct, Brian. It is.
So it's sad that our society is corrupted to the point that they could have done something wonderful for every household, you know, and rectified the problems.
Yes, there's something that happened this morning, and I'm going to let you go find it for yourself. It's all over the news. You again may or may not pick up on the significance of it, the gravity of it. This morning, it was officially announced by Washington, D.C., about the tax. And you know that they're calling Obamacare, they're calling the Medicare system, they're calling it a tax, they're not calling it a premium. I know you, I'm sure you recognize that the Supreme Court said it's not a premium, it's a tax.
I have heard that.
Yes, they announced how much that tax is going to be this morning.
I couldn't
believe what I was seeing. You've got to go on some of the websites and pick this up. It's all over the web.
Dear Lord.
The national news will have it on it. And it is you, every family in America, you have no choice. As of January 1st of next year, you will pay this tax, or you will be fined by the federal government an exorbitant amount if you do not take part in Obamacare. And the amount that was officially announced today, that every family in America will be paying for Obamacare next year, you've got to go get it. I don't want to give it to you. Now, when I began the program, I said, I'm not going to give you doom and gloom. I'm going to give you facts and figures that will spare you a lot of heartache. And what I've tried to do today is to give you facts, documentation, names, and places. Now, the other one that took place just within hours ago was announced by our government. I want you to go find this one out for yourself because I don't want to give it to you. Mm-hmm. You've got to know what you will, whether you like it or not, pay for Obamacare beginning January the 1st of next year. And whenever you find out what it is, I want you to tell me if you can afford to do it. Now, I won't be able to talk to you personally, but you can just speak wherever you are and say, Lindsay, this is what it is. You've got to go find it out. Now, I didn't do this. This is not a prediction on my part. This is a statement of the federal government today in relation to Obamacare, which will have its inception as of January the 1st of next year.
Well, I got a feeling just by your tone and what you're saying that we ain't going to like it. That's just a feeling here, Lindsay. Oh, my goodness. So this is devastating to me. Now, I also, Lindsay, heard that China has boycotted buying Japanese products. So I don't know if the currency war is somewhat between those two countries as well as against the Western world, or what do you know of that? Anything?
I heard that they had some problems amongst themselves, but I didn't understand that it was going to be a permanent thing.
Well, I don't know that it's permanent, but I think the Chinese government, from what I heard, has officially said don't buy any Japanese products. And that's probably a temporary, what do they call that, sanction. You know, and of course, being a communist country, they could probably actually enforce that, you know, or do a heavy taxation. When I was in Korea, Lindsay, back in the 1990s, if you bought an automobile that was not manufactured in Korea, you paid 100% sales tax. I said that right, 100% sales tax. And you paid a higher tax annually when you renewed your license plate. So you essentially, if a guy wanted to roll in an S-Class Mercedes, he was going to buy it twice, once for himself and once for the government. Now, that was in 1990, okay? Mm. And so you know that, and that's not a that wasn't China, that was Korea, that was South Korea, Lindsay. That was not even a communist country. That was our ally in that region. So it's like, if they could do that then, you know what China could do.
Yes.
If they took a hurt and a feeling like they don't want to play nicely with another country, be it Japan or America or anybody in between. Scary thoughts. I mean, the Chinese, it's the greatest population and, as you said, the third largest economy. So they're definitely a player. And teaming up with the second largest, they've got us beat, I would say, wouldn't you, if you put Japan and China together?
Yeah, they definitely do. And our Federal Reserve has literally destroyed us. If they had just been honest with the American people. But instead, they came out with QE1, QE2, kept telling us it had to be done. Now they have created a monstrosity. And there's nothing they can do about it. They've created this monster, and it's about to eat the American people.
It's like the blood.
So we definitely are facing some days that you need to be aware of what's going on, and that's the reason that I am so appreciative, Brian, that you would allow me to be on your show today, And we're going to see things happening like this on a regular basis that everyone positively must be aware of. Once again,
wow.
Take down our toll-free number, if you will. The
yes.
DVD series we just produced entitled The Next 4 Years, and the companion series that goes with it, How to Survive the Next 4 Years. And our toll-free number again, 888-799-6111. Or you can go on the web, if you wish, to prophecyclub.com, P-R-O-P-H-E-C-Y-C-L-U-B.com. Now, there's a gentleman in United Kingdom, Great Britain, who set up a website in my name. It's not mine. You know, I was told a number of years ago not to have one. And I've been trying to give him material as I can. We gave him an emergency bulletin this morning. You'll find things posted there on a regular basis. You'll find all of the radio shows that I'm on. In fact, your show right now, Brian, is listed on lindseywilliams.net. lindseywilliams.net. And many people are listening to this program right now because they found out from that website how to listen to it. And they follow me on different programs where I am, so they can get the very latest of information that's being given. I would urge you to go there from time to time. And in the top of the page, of the front page, you'll find a health section. Now, with Obamacare coming in January the 1st of next year, you're going to have to learn to be your own doctor. And every time that we can, find something that will help you to learn to be your own doctor and take care of your family. We're listing it there. So I would urge you from time to time, go to lindseywilliams.net, you'll find some help there.
I see the health, the little link for it at the top. Yes, I do. Okay,
yes.
That's great. Yeah. Yeah, you're right. An ounce of prevention is literally becoming a pound of cure, folks. Lindsay is right about that. My goodness. Well, Lindsay, we sure thank you for coming on tonight and sharing all this with us, giving us this little lesson in economics. Wow, that's like two nights in a row. I got a little economic lesson the other night. I don't know if it's last night or the night before. But, wow, thank you so much. And let's say a quick prayer as we depart. Amen. Lord, touch Lindsay right now and his team of people, whoever's helping him to produce these videos. Lord, help them to get this word out. Help us to be prepared. Help us to not fear, most importantly, as we covered last night in the message, Lord, and to be thankful for what you've given us, Lord, over the years, through our lives, how you've provided, Lord, and let us use the recollection of those provisions to realize that you are our source and you will provide for us still in the face of all this. God, protect those that love you, that remnant Christian group, and God, strengthen them to go through these hard times with peace and joy. And bless Lindsay and his team and in their tapes that they're putting out, Lord, that we can be prepared. Thank you in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. Thank you, Brian. Lord bless now, and you have a great evening.
Yes, sir. God bless you, Lindsay. All right, ladies and gentlemen, you got the 411 on where to go to get some of that. We're going to take a quick break, and we'll be back with Dr. Chris Ward.
Yeah. But know your breakthrough.
What we want you to do.
So hold on.
Yes.
You are too close to give up.
You have so much to live for.
You have so much to live for.
Remember what you prayed for.
Remember what you prayed for.
Yes.
Hold on.
Don't give up.
Please don't let go in this season. Know that now is going to be great for.
So no matter what you're going through right now. Come on, Monica.
You ask, will this go away? Know that God can feel your pain. Believe he'll never fall short of his word. Sometimes we forget that he holds us in his hands, but I
listen.
You just hold on.
I'm speaking from experience. I was there. Just about over. But here's the good news. Listen.
All of your dreams.
Your dreams.
All of your desires.
Yes, they are. Yes, they
are.
Are
coming to pass.
Whoa, whoa.
Never let go, never let go. Welcome to the Radio Preacher Man Show, ladies and gentlemen, hallelujah. Well, that was Lindsey Williams in the first hour from lindseywilliams.net, and you can order those tapes he was telling us about for, at 888-799-6111 or go to prophecyclub.com. And our next guest is Chris Ward from logoschristian.org, and he is getting to be quite the prolific author himself, and we're glad to have you, Chris. How are you, my brother?
I'm great. How are you tonight, Brian?
Well, I feel all right.
Yeah. Can you hear me okay?
Yes, sir.
Yes. Good. You sound great.
Coming through loud and clear. I always get a little second wind during that 7 o'clock break somehow, maybe getting up and moving around, and it's good for me. So now, Chris, I know you've got a new book coming out.
Yeah.
And I don't know if that's something we can discuss a little bit while we got you on tonight, or if you had something more important, or not more important, but different on your mind, by all means. But if you want to tell us a little bit about your new book, the title of it, and where we can get a copy of that.
Yes, it should be out on the market in the next couple of weeks. It's called okay. Satan and Lucifer Decoded.
That's right.
Mm-hmm. Satan and Lucifer Decoded. And what I do is I go right back to Hammurabi and the first religion and talk about how he created this duality concept between a creator God and an angry evil God. He created that mindset, and that mindset has carried itself through many religions, including Christianity. And so here we are today, and Satan has preyed on that. He's used that as his advantage so that he's presented himself as two different people.
Interesting.
And the scripture does tell us that Satan's seed is where we look at the Antichrist. And many times the people I encounter in our outreach ministry, they're Luciferians, and they're involved in all kinds of Luciferian worship. And they will openly admit they're Luciferians. And then when you ask them about Satan, they'll say, well, Lucifer is Satan. And you say, well, why do you choose to be Luciferian? And they'll tell you right up front, it's like magic. You got white magic, you got black magic. And they choose the more beneficial side, as if there's two sides of this coin.
My goodness.
Yeah, it's really confusing for Christians, because when you hear things like the New World Order is trying to replace the Old World Order, etc., right away Christians think, well, they're talking about us, and they're trying to get rid of us. No, you're not even part of the picture. The real picture is that the Old World Order is Satan and his draconian rule, and the New World Order is Lucifer in his spirit of enlightenment, because he is the Prince of Light. Satan is the prince of darkness, and Lucifer is the prince of light. So when they talk about these battles between Old World Order and New World Order, they're not even including the Christians. The Christians are considered just something that's in the way, and not to be necessary or appropriate to talk about.
Well, Chris, even from a Christian perspective, I never differentiated in my lifetime between Lucifer and Satan either. I always thought that that was just another name for Satan, Lucifer. Was I wrong for that?
Well, actually, you're just a victim. Uh-huh. Like many people in the Christian church, they've fallen into this duality, and they don't realize that this is all a scheme of the devil. That we all recognize that the Antichrist will be the seed of Satan, and we all recognize that Satan himself, like Jesus Christ, Satan will take and give his kingdom to his son, which will be the beast, and that's why he's called the beast in Revelation. He's not called Satan. He's called the beast. The beast rises up out of the sea. The sea is humanity. Well, that beast that rises up is actually the seed of Satan, as we see in Genesis chapter 3 and in verse 15. So it's funny, Christians have the background, but it's like almost if nobody wants to put it together for them and tell me exactly what all this means. But when I mention these things, they say, yeah, that sounds right. Well, yeah, that sounds right. But they would never for a second realize that these are two incredibly different beings. In fact, that it's like saying that you don't recognize the difference between God and Jesus. Now, Jehovah Elohim and Jesus are eternals, all right?
Mm-hmm.
Jesus is the manifestation of the Father. And Satan and Lucifer are created beings. And right. Satan actually participated in the creation of Lucifer. So, you know, there's no comparison. You can't compare apples and oranges here. A lot of people think...
Certainly not, no.
They're not
like a triune thing, like Jesus and God and the Holy Spirit come to the triune Godhead, if you will, and like a man is body, soul, and spirit. What is this? Is this just like another imitation of the devil to come up with two or three... to imitate God? Is this another part of this equation?
Look what he's orchestrated here at the end of the age. Everybody's talking about the New World Order. Well, what was the Old World Order? Was the Old World Order Christianity? No. It was Satan. In fact, look at the Muslims. They're going after America, and what do they call us? They call us Satanist America.
Yeah, the great Satan.
Yeah. And so they consider themselves part of the New World Order, getting rid of the Old World Order, Satan, and replacing it with Lucifer.
Wow. Well, that doesn't...
And it's a really dynamic kind of a trick. It's really magic, what he's done here, and people just fall for it. And the church has not been articulate, you know, outside some of the great halls and some of the great scholars. They understand this. But the average church person doesn't realize that Satan's going to do the same thing that Father God did. Father God, Jehovah Elohim, or Jehovah Abba, however you want to say it, gave his kingdom to his son. And so what we're looking at right now, the old world order is being replaced. That's the satanic dark kingdom, the prince of darkness, is being replaced by the Prince of Enlightenment, the Prince of Light.
Uh-huh.
And not to be confused with Jesus Christ, who is the light of the world. This is a spiritual kind of a light, you know, kind of a like false teaching light. And this
the new age.
Yeah, it's right there in front of you. If you ever look at a yin and a yang, you know how it's black and white?
Yes.
Well, the black is Satan, and the white is Lucifer. Jesus Christ, Father God, the Holy Spirit are not factored in that at all.
No.
And they try to tell you that what Satan did was he realized that we needed to get from the tree of knowledge, we needed to get our own set of knowledge so that we could be more balanced. We could see the wicked side as well as the good side. And that way we'd be better, more balanced human beings. We'd make better decisions. Well, it sounds good, but since the fall, when have we ever made a good decision? We even crucified Jesus Christ as mankind.
Yes, I know. No, we don't have a great track record. You're absolutely right, Chris.
And here we are at the end of the age, and the average Christian, when I tell them that you need to understand the duality of Satan and Lucifer, because Lucifer is being presented to you right now on this planet, and you don't even have a clue.
Wow. That's true. Did I just lose you, or are you still there?
I'm still here. Can you hear me?
Oh, okay. Yeah. I heard it drop off real fast when you said we don't have a clue, and then I heard a noise. I thought I lost you, but speaking of we don't have a clue, how about this Luciferian elite, like the politicians that are moving to make all this New World Order come to pass, and they are accused of being Luciferian, many of them, and I won't mention names, but many politicians are accused of being Luciferian. Are they also Satanists, Chris, or do they not realize that they're worshiping satanic figure?
At the very top, there's the combination of these fallen angels and hybrids. But at the next level, the level that mankind knows most commonly is we refer to today as the Illuminati. And these people are basically Satanists. Many of them are fifth-degree witches. But they all understand that we're trying to destroy the old world order and replace it with a new world order, which will be ruled by his son, Lucifer. And most Christians don't get this. They don't realize that these people are really excited about our destruction. You know, that we're just mere happenstance. We just happen to be in the way. But we're not part of the old world order or the new world order. That is a complete political switch that's taking place right now, and we have no control over it.
A complete what kind of switch?
It's a political switch.
Okay.
And the goal is this. First of all, Lucifer's plan is to get rid of the old world order using the new world order. That means a coalition of some countries, a coalition of some wealthy people, like the Rockefellers and Disney and people like that. And then once he gets in place, he is like a Führer, like Hitler. He's going to actually rise to be the only one in the end. It's kind of like an advanced version of Highlander, which used to be a TV program where in the end there will only be one. And that one will be Lucifer. Satan will completely give his entire kingdom over to his son, Lucifer. And Lucifer will rule this world with a draconian fist.
Wow. That's not good. Now, and so Lucifer is the beast that rises. Yeah.
Sorry.
Yeah, I'm sorry. Yeah. I'm thinking out loud. Apollo? Is that another name? Is Apollo another name for Lucifer? Some claim that Apollo is the son of Satan. Is this going to play a part?
In my book, I go to great lengths to show you that the real thing to worry about is the concentration of light or enlightenment, because that's how Lucifer will actually get the whole world to follow him. It's through the occult and through magic and black magic and witchcraft.
Okay.
That's how he can get the whole world to unite behind him. And the sad part is many Christians are involved in that too. They think that they're actually operating at a new modern Christian level. But in fact, they're working for the beast.
Wow. And so why would they do that? If they're Christian faith, they just don't have a good knowledge of the Bible due to years of neglecting to read it?
Let me give you a really common example.
All right.
Okay, you and I are old-time Christians, and we believe that you'll know they're Christians by their fruit.
Mm-hmm.
Well, the President of the United States, for example, he says he's a Christian, but he also was fathered the bill for partial birth abortions.
Right.
And the Bible is very clear that we do not shed innocent blood.
Mm-hmm.
So somewhere there along the line, you start checking out abortion, And you'll find out that as high as 82% of all women who have an abortion are women of faith.
Wow.
They're not Satanists.
That's not good.
They're not, yeah, they're not Satanists. They're not Luciferians. They're people in the church. And so when you go to, like, 2 Thessalonians chapter 2, and I'm just going to go there because I want to read this exactly
where
it is. But 2 Thessalonians chapter 2, you get down to verse 3, and it says, "Let no man deceive you." Now, that would mean me too, wouldn't it?
Oh, yes. Mm-hmm.
You don't even want me to deceive you, not by any means.
No.
"For that day shall not come, except there come a falling away first, and that man of sin be revealed, the son of perdition." Now, let me read it slower, okay? First of all, when you read it in the Greek, it says that there will be a falling away. "That day shall not come unless there is a falling away." The word in the Greek is apostasia. It's where we get the word apostasy. Now, the world cannot be apostate. Only the church can be apostate.
Right. The world's lost already.
The world's already lost. And so then it says, once the church is apostate, what's the result? The man of sin is revealed.
Wow. Dear Lord. So
I'm here right now. People always want to know, well, where are we in the book of Revelation? You know, what year are we in? And things like that. I say, look, man, we can't even get past 2 Thessalonians chapter 2, verse 3. We are already there for sure. We've got churches out there that their leaders of their church are gay and openly practice gay people. We have 82% of the body of Christ of women getting abortions. You know, we could stop abortion tomorrow if all the Christians who have abortions just stopped.
Yeah.
And we could stop abortion in a week, and we wouldn't have to make one vote.
Wow. That doesn't seem like that would be that tall of an order. You know, just to ask Christian women not to abort their children, that would seem
right.
Like, especially the Catholic Church has always stood against abortion to begin with, and that's a huge quasi-Christian
The Catholic Church,
thing.
They represent more than 35% of those women of faith who have abortions. The rest are Protestants. Only about 6% are Jewish.
Wow.
So the Protestant Church, you know, the Protestant Church, are some of the worst offenders. Now, I'm not a denomination. I'm non-denominational. I grew up a Catholic. I was Pentecostal, and then I was in another church, etc. But I'm independent anymore because all the modern churches, they try to keep you locked in that old world church, and then you can't see what's going on. You can't see the new world order being totally decimated by Lucifer.
Wow.
In the new world order. You're just living in darkness. You have no idea. People are asking, like, well, what week of Revelation are we in? I mean, come on, give me a break. It's not a week anyway. It's a
now,
year.
We were in 2 Thessalonians where you were just reading. Doesn't that go directly into talking about the that which restrains being removed?
Yes, it does. First, in verse 4, it'll talk about this wicked one, this son of perdition. And he says, "Who opposes us and exalteth himself above all that is called God." Okay? So who is that? Why doesn't he just say Satan?
Huh.
Why is it left open for you to imagine who this person would be that is called God, or that is worshipped, so that he, as God, sitteth in the temple of God, showing himself that he is God. Now, everybody knew in the early church who Satan was, so why don't they spell it out here? Because it's part of the mystery. The man to reveal is to be revealed. The man, the son of perdition, is being revealed now, because we got men who claim to be Christians, like President Barack Obama. He says he's a Christian, but he also fathered the bill on partial birth abortion. We got 82% of women of faith having abortions. I mean,
that's
just
yeah. That's apostasy, I would say, or a good example of it.
It is apostasy. It is, and you know, and that word, you know, when you take a look at that word, apostasy, and you say, well, what does it mean? First of all, it's a feminine word, okay? I think that's important to note. It's a feminine word. And defection from truth, you know, properly.
That's
state.
What it means,
it's
essentially.
Church.
Defection.
Yeah, fallen away, forsaken.
Wow. Okay,
it's kind of interesting that, you know, the two examples I give you here, one of them is partial birth abortion, the other one's abortion, and the word itself, apostasia, is feminine.
Yeah, that is interesting. Very, very interesting.
See, most people don't really study this stuff to any depth. But once the son of perdition, okay, this is the son of hell. Okay, now, how can you be the son of perdition if you're Satan? Who is your father?
Right. And Jesus did tell the Pharisees, you know, you are of your father the devil. So they were kind of forerunners to this Lucifer and this beast system. I guess they were kind of a type of...
call him the son of perdition, which means ruin or loss, damnable, destruction, you know, perdition, pernicious ways. Why do you have to be the son of? Why couldn't you just say the man of perdition?
Well, I guess that gives good credence to your theory.
Yes, it does. And if we go back to Genesis, and you go to chapter 3, and then jump on down to verse 15. Now, remember, I didn't write this book. I'm just reading it.
Sure.
Okay? And if I misinterpreted it, God asks you to judge me.
All right.
You know, so God is asking you right now, if you're a believer, and if this man's talking and he's trying to show me something, reveal something about the end of the age and who the son of perdition is, then I better listen. And I better check it against the word of God.
Mm-hmm.
Isn't that correct?
That's right.
Let's read this.
All right.
I will put enmity between thee and the woman, and between thy seed and her seed. It shall bruise thy head, and thou shalt bruise his heel. So, whoa, excuse me a minute, but what does that mean? I'm going to put enmity between you and the woman and between thy seed and her seed.
Well, I've heard a lot of folks talk about the theory of the serpent seed in the garden, and then you got the two separate seeds, you know, the seed of Satan and the seed of God, which would be man. Now, is that where you're going with that, Chris?
Exactly.
You're going a different way.
You know, by the time you get to Revelation 12:7, in verse 17, it says, "And there was war in heaven. Michael and his angels fought against the dragon, and the dragon fought in his angels." And then in verse 17, Revelation 12:17, "And the dragon was wroth with the woman, and went to make war with the remnant of her seed, which kept the commandments of God and have the testimony of Jesus Christ." So, you know, a lot of people like to just sum that up and say, well, they're just trying to see this difference between the true believers and the pagans. New. This was written 2,000 years ago. They were all pagans.
Well, that was Revelation, what, 12:17?
12:17, yeah. And so here you have the beginning of the Bible in 3:15, his seed and her seed, and then you get to Revelation 12:17, and again, the devil was wroth with the woman and went to make war with the remnant of her seed, which kept the commandments of God and have the testimony of Jesus Christ.
Wow. And the dragon was wroth with the
real
woman.
It's real challenge, isn't it?
Remnant of her seed. Remnant's a funny thing because we use that word all the time. God has always kept a remnant. Even way back in the Old Testament when the Jews were about to be decimated, they would always be a remnant, right. Even as recently as World War II. And there's always a remnant.
Even as recent as right now. Yeah. That the Jewish state over there is a secular humanistic state like America. It's not a Jewish state. It's just a state of Jews. But there is a remnant in Israel.
Right.
And that's when they say pray for Israel. That's what the Bible means. You know, pray for the remnant of Israel. You know, I'm not going to pray that they don't allow Jews in the country that have become Christians.
Wow.
That would be
No. We want to. They're on our side, definitely. So I was going to ask you a little bit.
Sometimes they're on our side. Sometimes they shouldn't be. You know?
Yeah.
Sometimes they're wrong. Like, you know, we just give F-18s to Egypt this week.
Yeah. That's troubling. I mean, when you think about
it's
even the history of Egypt, did you realize, I just realized, I know you realized, but I just was reading the other day in the Word of God, and it jumped right off the pages that Hagar was an Egyptian. You know, Abraham's, the handmaid of Sarah, who fathered Ishmael, was actually from Egypt. And
that's right.
So Egypt has such a rich history. And then they captured the Israelis. That was Egypt again. For 400 years, they were slaves to Egypt, you know? And
right.
Then now, who's rising up against Israel again? Egypt, it looks like.
You know, this country, we're not even like 400 years old, you know?
Right.
And can you imagine if Jews had been with us for 400 years? Nobody would remember a time that they came from somewhere else.
Mm-hmm. True that.
Look at for example, blacks came from Africa. They've been here a couple hundred years, and we're now, you know, starting to recognize them as black Americans.
I could give you a good example of that myself. My great-grandmother, when she was well into her 90s, we asked her, my wife and I, where our ancestors are from. And you know what her answer was, Chris? She was born in 1899. Her answer was, well, we've always lived in America as far as I know. And she was born in 1899. America wasn't a country until 1776. So that was only 100 years from the time America became a country to the time she was born. And she couldn't tell us our ancestry, you know, unless she'd just forgotten or conveniently didn't want to tell us. I don't know. It just seems odd that you wouldn't know if you were 100 years old nearly, that you wouldn't know if your parents were of Swedish nature or German or what our heritage was, you know.
I just
found that to be interesting.
Well, one more thing before we go on here about his seed and her seed.
Mm-hmm.
The word in Hebrew for seed here is the same. You know, some places you go and Daniel says they will mix his seed with the seed of men. They use a different word. But here, his seed is Sarah and her seed is Zerah.
Okay. So that's coming out of Genesis 3 and Revelation 12:17, I believe it was.
Well, we were just in Genesis 3:15, and that's where his seed is against her seed. And then the last reference was again Revelation 12, mm-hmm. verse 7 and 17. And 17 really puts it together because you go all the way from the third chapter of Genesis to one of the last eight chapters of the book of Revelation, and they're still talking about the difference between his seed and her seed.
Amazing. And they're using the same Hebraic word for seed.
Right.
That's very, very deep because
very same.
They change their words a little here and there if the meaning's different. And I think that's important.
And the word in the Hebrew, of course, is Sarah, but in the Greek, it's sperma.
Mm-hmm.
So her seed is the same as his seed, and the word used there is sperma. So it's not like, see, they have words like, if you're mixing animal seeds, they have words like that, like chimera and stuff. Mm-hmm. When you start mixing humans and animals, you have this new thing, which they call transponded human beings. And in the Greek, they would identify that. Which always amazed me in the Greek was whenever you study the word for drunken in the New Testament, because you know, we're going into the Greek, but if you type in the word drunk or drunken, let me see if I can do that real quick here.
I wanted to ask you while you're looking that up, the word apostasia, that you said is a defection from truth, essentially. Is that what we commonly would call backslidden in the modern church lingo?
Yes, we call it backsliding, but that's not appropriate. People talk about backsliding because they believe in concepts like once saved, always saved, which the Bible doesn't say. But
right.
The bottom line is, when you're talking about apostasy, it's not backsliding. You don't have any back left.
Or is it, so it's turned over to a reprobate mind even then, kind of an apostasy? Is it like too far gone, or is there still hope for those people that are in an apostate mind?
Well, I'll ask that question. You know, if you've been saved once by the blood of Christ, what saves you again the second time, you know? And those are good questions. I'm not going to pretend I have answers to that. I hope everybody can always return to the Lord. I know that Paul cast three guys back to Satan, and they were believers, and they started to fall. And before they fell so far, they lost their salvation. He would say that we'll turn them over to Satan for the destruction of their flesh, for the salvation of their soul.
Yes.
So there is a time period there when you are sliding backwards where you can still be saved. You know, and hopefully, Paul was hoping that they would get killed or something before they lost their salvation.
Wow, I remember that.
Three times.
That was three different occasions.
Okay, here's one I got for you. You're going to love this. Now, you realize that, you know, we're dealing with an age that's just all kinds of drugs out there.
Right.
You know, marijuana, you name it, LSD, meth, etc. If you go to the New Testament... starting with like Matthew 24:49.
Mm-hmm.
You know what the word is for drunken?
Let's see. There's a word, pharmakia. Is that coming into play there?
No. Pharmakia has to do with sorcery and drugs and sorcery. But in Matthew 24:49, he says, "And shall begin to smite his fellow servants." And you eat and drink with the drunken. So, who are the drunken in the Greek? Very interesting word. It's interesting because this was written 2,000 years ago. It's interesting because the word for drunken is methuo. It's the Greek methuo. And it's where we get the word today for meth.
Are you kidding?
I'm not
kidding.
No
way.
Absolutely. In fact, if you go to Luke 12:45, same thing. Drink and to be drunken, methusko. You go to Luke 17:8, it's to drunken, how do they put it? Like, I've eaten and drunken, and the word there, it's a different application. And then you get to Acts 2:15. Drunken, it's methuo. 1 Corinthians 11:21, it's methuo. 1 Thessalonians 5:7, that they that be drunken, methusko, and are drunken, methuo. So, I mean, meth is used for the drunken twice there, in that one chapter. And then in the last one, Revelation 17:6, which is one verse ahead of 17:7, it says that, and I saw the woman drunken, methuo, with the blood of the saints. So, picture this. When you think of the whore that rides the beast, excuse me.
Oh, yeah.
She's sitting on that beast, that seven-headed dragon. She's not just drinking the blood of the saints. She's literally inhaling the blood of the saints. Just like meth users use meth.
Do you think that that's implying that the blood of the saints are going to be intoxicated with meth essentially.
Yes. In fact,
that's what would be getting her drunk.
What it means
drinks
is
their blood. I mean, that's getting kind of far out.
Yeah, these Illuminati, all of these, what I call the Andromedae, the mixture between the fallen angels and the human, the hybrids and the transponded human beings, they actually sacrifice human beings, even today. Mm-hmm. And in this case, you know, they drink the blood. Oh, they go way beyond just drinking the blood. They are literally making drugs out of the blood.
Oh, God. That's terrible.
And using the blood as drugs, as methyl.
Wow. They actually make a drug, and the blood is the base of it, you know? So
yeah.
we're not talking Bloody Marys here. We're talking serious drugs.
We're talking about bloody Christians. We're talking about when they sacrifice human beings, when they do these seven human sacrifice every year, like the Feast of the Bride, when Satan picks out his bride. Now, why does he pick out a bride every September 7th? This is just 4 days before 9/11. Why does Satan have to pick out a bride? Because Satan is going to have a son.
Okay.
And if you know anybody that's come out of Satanism, they will tell you, yes, they sacrifice women and children, little girls, and yes, they drink the blood. What they don't tell you is what do they do to the blood before they drink it?
Yeah,
many of them don't know. Yeah, you never hear him talk about that. You know, I had the privilege of leading Jess LaVey to the Lord. That was Anton LaVey's son. And I got to do healing and deliverance with him. And I even did a Halloween radio show with him one time. It's on my webpage. You can listen to the interview. And he talks quite frankly how there are Satanists in the FBI that have helped him cover up the fact that, yes, they do kidnap women and children. About 1 million every year in this country are never found. About 2 million are actually captured, and they find half of them, but they never find any record of the other half. Why is that? Because they literally transform them into drugs.
And, oh, my God. So that's like what the meth... Do you think that that's a part of what they're using to make meth, even, or do you think...
Absolutely. Absolutely.
Because I had no idea what's in meth.
Don't anybody try to talk you out of this one, either. This one is the real thing. And I've been working with satanically, ritualistically abused people, you know, for the last 20 years. And I can just tell you right now, these people, they don't even want to talk about it.
Wow.
You know, I won't even mention anybody else's name. I only mention Jess.
Your database has been updated.
Excuse me, my computer's updating. I only mention Jess because he actually allowed me to do that. But, you know, I've had so many cases, so many witches that have come to the Lord, and I would never mention their names because they would kill them.
Yeah. I guess I've seen pictures before and after of a meth user, like after 3 years and after 6 years and 9 years, and the terrible condition that they become after just a few years using that drug, and they almost look like zombies, you know, at the end of like 7 or 8 years. They're looking really rough. Do you think that's due to this, what you're saying about there's some base to this meth and methamphetamine that is blood of people?
Well, you know,
it's bad for humans to consume blood. I mean, we know in the Old Testament they were not to consume even blood of animals, you know.
You know, you can walk through any mall, you can go through any airport, and you can pick out the people that are doing meth.
Mm-hmm.
You don't need drugs. You don't need a dog. You don't need a dog that's trained to spot drugs. You can just tell. They're the skinniest people in the room.
Is that right? Okay. Because
If some people are naturally skinny, it's not that common anymore. Once you're over 30, it's a battle. But if you're doing drugs, you never worry about that, man. You just go back on the drugs and get your weight where you want.
Well, do they not eat, or does it just jack up their metabolism, or what do you think is...
Well, okay, now, you have to understand, this is like the opposite of pot. If you smoke a lot of pot, you get really hungry, and a lot of pot smokers are and kind of plump.
They get
when
the
you're
munchies.
Doing meth, you don't ever hear about how the meth have to always go to a weight farm.
Yeah.
That's not happening.
Okay.
So anyways, let me get back to my book a little bit, because
yeah.
All I've done was get the idea here, you know. I'm trying to show you that, look, Satan has a son, and he thinks he's the real God in the real kingdom, and so Father God turned his kingdom over to his son, because Jesus sits at the right hand of the Father. So Satan is doing the same thing, and in the end of the age, you'll see that. Go to Revelation 13. Revelation chapter 13. Okay, we'll get there too. And incidentally, too, if you bring your laptop, I'll put this Power CD Bible on your computer for you.
Yeah.
And then you can have the interlinear, and you can look at the Hebrew and the Greek, and I'll show you what to do with it, okay?
All right.
Look at the first sentence in Revelation 13:1. And I stood upon the sand of the sea. Now, the sea is humanity. And I saw a beast rise up. Now, right there, let's just stop right there for a second. It's not Satan. It's a beast. And it's pronounced Therion. And actually, in the original Greek, it's Herion. And a Herion is any seven-headed serpent dragon.
Oh, dear.
Seven-headed serpent dragon. So then that's what we see, and it says this. I saw a beast rise up out of the sea. So he comes out of humanity, having seven heads and ten horns, and upon his horns ten crowns, and upon his heads the name of blasphemy. So people always think, well, what is this thing? Well, he's got seven heads, he's got ten horns, and on his horns are ten crowns. And upon his head, the name of blasphemy. So what are we looking at? 7 and 10 is 17. And 10 is 27.
All right.
See
that.
So what we've got here is a very interesting combination. Because in the book of Micah, it talks about in the end times, there will be seven countries that will come to the side of Israel. And, of course, it doesn't name all of them, and we always hope and pray that America will be one of them. But notice here, Satan is building his kingdom with his son, the beast. And a beast, this particular Therion, means that he's not fully human, he's not fully something else.
Wow.
He's a beast. You know, it's like if you took a reptilian and bred it with a human, you'd come up with a beast.
Right, right. So he's partly reptilian even, perhaps.
Absolutely. Absolutely. In fact, if you understand the history of Babylon, the king of Babylon was Nimrod. This is about the time of Isaiah, between Isaiah and Ezekiel. And Nimrod was married to a woman called Semiramis. And she was a goddess, and he was a god. So they were both like titans. They were... the children of angels who fell and bred with women, okay? And they produced these children who were hybrids. So they were like half fallen angel and half human. Do you get the picture?
Yeah, that's the Nephilim, right?
That's the Nephilim. Well, what most people don't know is the backbreeding program. Because when you have two children who are Nephilim, and they have sex and they breed another child, guess what? This child is now one-fourth human being and three-fourths fallen angel.
Oh, my. I didn't think about that.
It's Lucifer. Pardon?
I never thought about that. How, you know.
It's just them. Just take, 50-50 and they have sex again with each other. Now, that thing is more fallen angel than it is human. That's a beast.
Wow. I'll be.
You see how it works? And you only need to know how to do fractions. You don't need to do calculus or anything like that. You just go back and do your old fractions here. In verse 2, Revelation 13:2, and the beast, again, it doesn't call him Satan. They know who Satan is. He uses Satan in verse 12 and 18. But here again, he's using beasts, just like he did in 1 Thessalonians, the son of perdition. You know, why aren't they using the word Satan? Because it's not Satan. And the beast which I saw was like unto a leopard, and his feet were as the feet of a bear, and his mouth as the mouth of a lion, and the dragon gave him his power, his seat, and his great authority. Now, underline the dragon.
Dragon gave him his power.
Now, yes, how sir. Could the dragon give himself power?
Interesting. So, the dragon is the father figure.
The dragon is Satan. And it's very clear to the New Testament Christians, the dragon is always Satan. When you go back to 12...
Plus, we know that at the end, when the Antichrist is cast into the lake of fire, that was Satan and the false prophet are already there, right?
Well, yeah, but that's not till the end.
Okay.
So the beast, the Antichrist, and the false prophet, I mean, it's the false prophet. So the dragon, the beast, and the false prophet will all be in the lake of fire. So, obviously, the false prophet is the opposite of the Holy Spirit.
Right.
Okay? So, the dragon is Satan, so the beast is Lucifer.
Uh-huh.
Okay?
Yeah.
Now, watch this. If you look at, and you know, your wife is probably more familiar with this than most Christians, but you can always run this by her later and check me out and see if I'm correct. But one of the occult organizations that is considered to be a UFO organization is the GFL, the Galactic Federation of Light. And they talk about this relationship. And guess what they have? They've got their leader, who they say is Lucifer. And they say that Lucifer is sponsored by Satan. And guess who the false prophets are?
Wow, you got me.
The channelers.
The channelers.
These human beings that let the aliens talk through them. These are channelers. They're the false prophets.
Okay, channelers who let the aliens talk. So these are people that are claiming alien abduction? Or are they doing seance?
Yes, it's like a seance. And in fact, in my book, I go to great degree to explain exactly what's going on there. It's not like the angels came and talked to the shepherds and said, you know, upon the earth today, the Son of God has been born. They don't talk like that. No,
okay.
They have to talk through a human being.
That's why we had the prophets, yeah.
That's right. These Galactic Federation of Light has these channelers. I have a list of all of them. And I can tell you that they will sit down. One of them just recently, in last year, actually went to the United Nations and talked to the leaders of the United Nations through his channel. And that was Metatron. And I have the documented case and everything.
Holy smokes.
And this happened at the United Nations. And so their false prophets are channels or channelers. Now, you're going to say, well, how does that compare to the Holy Spirit? Well, the Holy Spirit speaks through all of us.
I heard about being channeled, this Metatron. I heard about something at the UN there was a channeling event. I did hear something about that, Chris.
Oh, yeah, and they covered it up. Maybe even tried to block it off the Internet.
Wow, that is so tripping. It's like, and we know they're going to do full disclosure one of these days. And I've had a lot of talks with people about the whole alien thing, and I was talking with somebody the other day about whether the ships that they've created, whether they're man-made or demonically made, or some, it could be a combination if you've got this reverse breeding going on, you know.
Well, we could talk all night on that aspect, because the bottom line is that those ships could actually be living beings.
The ships themselves.
Yes,
living beings.
In fact, look in the book of Daniel. Let's take the book of Ezekiel. When Ezekiel says, I saw this thing come down, and it had the face of a man, a lion, an ox, and an eagle. Did you know that's the four points of the zodiac?
No, I don't know that I consciously knew that, to be honest.
Yeah, it's true. Now, astrology changed it. They do the lion, the ox, the man, and the scorpion. But when
right.
God gave the Masterblock to Adam, he used the lion, the ox, the man, and the eagle. But later on, by the time you get to chapter 10, they got a whole mountain flying around.
Wow.
So you have to understand that whatever God does, believe me, Satan can counterfeit.
So
and,
maybe
and if
when...
we can do let's put it like this. We can now clone sheep, right?
Right.
So what are they not telling us? If we've learned to do this after 5,000 years of history, 5,000 years ago, you don't think Satan could have started cloning things?
Yes, I do believe he could have. In fact, C.K. Quarterman was on a few weeks ago, and he might have been the one that we were talking about, the ships, whether they
uh-huh.
were man-made or not. That his theory on Neanderthals is that... possibly Satan was given his attempt at creation. You know how God created man in his image, and maybe Satan decided to try his hand at creation, and he came up with the Neanderthals. You know, I don't know if you've looked into that at all.
The book called Dispensational Truth by C.S. Larkin, you'll find out that he teaches in the pre-Adamic race.
Mm-hmm. I think C.K.
I don't care what you call it. Yeah, I don't care what you call it. As Christians, we talk about when God created Adam and Eve.
Mm-hmm.
Because in the midst of whatever was going on in this universe, God came down here in the middle of a maximum security prison. You know, Satan was kicked out of heaven to earth. We know the story. Michael defeated him and his angels and cast him to earth. So God comes down here in the middle of this maximum security prison. He creates Adam and Eve.
Mm-hmm.
You know, you got to admit, God is feisty, man. He is so feisty. He doesn't, like, go find some hidden planet in the universe where Satan and his wicked angels will never find us. No, he comes right down here in their breadbasket.
Wow.
And creates us. And so whatever was going on before that, over the years, it's been so bastardized. It's really hard for us to put our finger on what happened before that. But it doesn't matter. We know what God did. God created Adam and Eve. And Satan was so insanely jealous, he had to intervene. And we see that intervention again in Genesis 6:4, when the watchers came down, made love to women, and produced all the Nephilim and all the girls.
Right.
And so this Satan seed is what's going to pop up at the end of the age, and the leader will be Lucifer.
Wow. So we are running headlong toward this fulfillment of the prophecy.
Oh, yeah.
And that's very concerning. Now, real quick, back to the, I won't go back to that again. We've beat that up pretty good. But I'm just concerned. I reach out to the backslidden folks all the time on this show and tell them, come on and get right with God. I believe God is calling back folks that have once loved him and worshipped him in spirit and truth who are not serving the Lord the way they should. Don't you kind of feel that in this last hour he's drawing some of those people home or drawing them to a higher level in their spiritual walk than they've known or that they've practiced in a long time?
We're at a crossroads. And people are choosing right now, are they going to serve God, or are they going to serve religion, or are they going to serve politics, or are they going to make politics serve them, or make people serve them through politics? But it all comes down
wow.
to one thing, and God is testing us.
Yeah.
And
yeah.
the hour of the...
Well,
and,
I just said to my wife not even 2 hours ago that If we have to suffer much persecution as a people, as some Christians are, that it's likely to strengthen them, to spread the gospel, to get us focused back on what's important, and that is serving God, because we've gotten so far from it.
Yes. So
it's, Let it's me like a diaspora too kind of effect.
Yeah.
Sure.
I want to kind of summarize for people why does they need to read my book.
Okay.
Because basically we're at a point where the old world order is going to be destroyed by the new world order, and then Lucifer is going to stand up and destroy them and take over everything. And this has nothing to do with the Christians. We're just in the way.
Yeah, you started to say that, so I'm not sure why you say that. Clarify that for us, Chris.
Yes, because when you look at the yin and the yang, for example, or you take white magic versus black magic, you know, or you take good Wicca versus bad Wicca, whatever you want to do, there's always this white and black version, but it's never about Christianity.
Wow, okay.
And so here we are at the end of the age, and there's this huge cosmic war going on this planet, and the Christians, they don't know what's going on. They don't have a clue what's going on. And so it's like you hear them that there's preppers, there's people getting ready for something. They know something's coming. I mean, they're spiritual people, but they don't know what. And my book will make it so clear to them, they'll know exactly what's going on, what's the plan, how it's going to unfold. And the most encouraging part is that, remember, this plan doesn't work. This plan will fail. In fact, one of my favorite descriptions is in Isaiah 34:7. He talks about when the Lord comes down. Excuse me. And he says, Isaiah
90 seconds.
And the unicorn shall come down with them,
mm-hmm.
and the bullocks with the bulls, and their land shall be soaked with blood, and their dust made fat with fatness. And it's interesting because at the very end of this thing, when the enemy thinks he's finally taken over the world, and now he can destroy all the Christians and get rid of everything that's been in his way.
60 seconds.
And the Lord appears. The Lord will appear, he'll come with his saints, he'll come with his angels, and he'll come up out of Petra, come into the east of Israel, stop the battle of Jehoshaphat, which will be by the Egyptians and the Palestinians, and the Syrians, and the those people in Turkey and Iran, etc., all the northern parts, Iraq, Afghanistan. They'll be caught in the Battle of Armageddon. And everybody south of that, the Palestinians and the Egyptians, will try to sneak up to the west. And when they get into Jerusalem, they actually destroy part of it and kill 7,000 people. And who appears? The Lord. He puts his feet in the mountain, and that mountain will split in half. It'll stop that
battle
in Jerusalem. And Lucifer will be exposed for what he is, a fake god.
Hallelujah.
He's got a fake plan. He's got a fake authority. And they don't even recognize us.
Wow. Now, we may be removed prior to that. The true believers should be removed.
God starts to destroy them, and he starts to do what the wrath of God is. We won't be here for that. That's why I'm kind of a pre-wrath Christian. I don't believe in pre-mid or post, but I do believe before God fights that final battle and destroys Lucifer and all his forces, we'll be taken out for that.
Yeah, because, I mean, it would be such a devastating time to be alive if we weren't.
Absolutely.
I mean, we weren't appointed to the wrath of God, thank goodness. And thank God he died for us. And we know that we may have to, some do, die for him and for the cause of the kingdom of God, but I pray that we would be found worthy to escape these things that we're seeing come upon the earth, Chris. That's where I'm at with that.
Yeah.
Not a big fond fan of persecution, but it is what it is. I don't think anybody is.
What's that? People will be able to get the book before the end of February. And I'm doing one last truth check this week, and then I will put it out. It's called Satan and Lucifer Decoded.
All right, and the author is Chris Ward. Or do you go by Christopher or Dr. Chris Ward? Or how
let me take a look. I think I just go by Chris Ward.
Okay.
Yeah, by Chris Ward, The American Exorcist.
Okay, and they'll be able to catch that on Amazon, I assume, or somewhere.
Yeah, it'll be on Kindle. It'll be on Lulu.com. It'll be on Amazon.com and all the others. And you can get it in black and white or color. I recommend you get the color. Wait till you see the pictures I have in here. It'll blow your mind.
Wow. It'll be like kind of like your artwork here. I'll hold up some of your artwork from this other book, The Yasha
yeah.
and the Secret of the Great
Rick
Pyramids.
Moore, he's a fantastic artist. And he's every time I tell him what I want, he sits down and draws it once. The
wow.
guy's amazing.
Yeah. That's pretty amazing. That's great. Well, God bless you, and thanks for coming on. We sure appreciate this. This has been a goodness gracious. I tell you, I take in so much knowledge from this show, I can't retain it. I think it rolls back out of one side, half of it. But I've learned tremendous things since I've started this show, I'll tell you, Chris, and I appreciate you. And I've got you in my prayers. I've been thinking about you. So, God bless you tonight.
Well, thank you, Brian. God bless you, too, and say hi to Monique.
All right. God bless everybody in the listening audience and those by archives. Be blessed in the name of Jesus. And we'll see you on Monday. Mm-hmm. And my boy, Troy.
I'm telling you what I read. I'm telling you what I know. God's got it.
You may think that it's over, that your life is done. The man.